Well, good evening, good evening. Welcome to the Perfect Balance Clinic Power Hour show. We've had many topics over this show. We've had many an athlete, many coaches. Tonight it's no different. It's time to inform, it's time to inspire, it's time to entertain you in the process as well. Now, this when we talk sport, usually the first thing that comes to most people's mind is non-disability sport, you know, and disability sport is something that comes in almost as a by the way sort of scenario. But that is not the case, and I'm happy tonight that my guest really is strong in that view. That disability sport does no longer belong to the awareness campaign. It really is about performance. Maria, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. Thank you
Indeed, you were at the 2018 Commonwealth Games and you represented England in the T35. Would you like just to enlighten me? There are too many numbers, you know, in the Paralympic sport, and my head sometimes goes wheezy with all these numbers. Would you like just to explain to me and many others that don't understand these numbers what exactly T35 is?
Sure. So I do athletics. So the first thing is track and field. So T stands for track and F stands for field. And then you come into the later category, which is the 30 category. And if you're in the 30s, that means you've got cerebral palsy. And then the level of your severity depends on the number that's in the 30s. So, for example, if you're a 31 to a 34, that means you're in a wheelchair. So you're racing a wheelchair. If you're 35, that means you are the most severe ambulant. So that's what category I fit in. And it goes all the way to a 38. So a 38 is the least severe athlete with cerebral palsy. So I am the most severe ambulant in that category. So that means I don't have any assistance when I run. I'm disabled to run without any kind of help. But if I was in a category lower, that means I would be a wheelchair athlete.
Well, thank you for, you know, explaining it, you know, all to us there in the manner that you have done. Now, T35, there's Maria as a T35 athlete, and you have the Commonwealth Games, and you even make the final. But would you like to tell us what that journey, the development journey, was like?
Yeah, it was an unexpected journey, to be honest. At that time, I was at university. So I was going into my second year. I'd just done my first year and I was staying at home, commuting into London to go to uni. And I carried on doing sports and training regularly. And then it got to the second year and I decided to move into a flat with some friends. And then all of a sudden, I just kind of got told that I've been selected. And it was completely out of the blue, to be honest. It was a welcome surprise. I was very happy, but at the same time, I didn't have a lot of time to prepare. I mean, I had been training consistently for 10 years. But to get that kind of opportunity, it just came when you least expect it. So I kind of went out there with that mentality of my first games at that level. I wanted to enjoy it as much as I could. I wanted to kind of learn from that whole experience of being with able-bodied athletes as much as power athletes. I've never really had that opportunity before. I mean, I've done school games, which is well known for teenagers essentially who are getting to that level. They're trying to understand the whole atmosphere of living in a village, just being surrounded by multi sports. Unless you're at an Olympics or a Paralympics, you don't really have that experience apart from the Commonwealth Games. So I kind of just went out there kind of thinking, I've got to enjoy it. Just kind of see what happens. You'll put too much pressure on myself. When I got out there, I don't have a bad word about it. It was the best kind of 3 weeks an athlete could really hope for.
Welcome to world with the broken and the beautiful collide. Don't know what you've heard, but the dark is what will lead you.
Memories, memories. Not so, Maria. That's the opening ceremony there. What do you remember about it?
The opening ceremony. There was a lot of confusion as to whether we would go. At the time, I was in the holding camp because the game was in Australia. And the opening ceremony was taking place down at the Gold Coast. So it was a bit of it was about two hours to get there, roughly. So we were a bit unsure whether the team were at holding camp was going to go. I kind of begged to go. I wanted to try and get out of the experience as we can. And thankfully, the coaches like, hey, you've got enough time for your event to kind of make that journey. Because it's quite a long haul when you're going all the way there. You then got the whole tournament, which upper athletes will know there's a lot of waiting around and standing around and kind of using up valuable energy. When I found out I was going, I was so excited. And then I actually think the whole traveling, because you got excited to get to the village, I'd have a little look around and kind of get a feel for it. Half of the team was split, so we hadn't arrived at the village. And then when we actually started getting our outfit for the opening ceremony, get on the coach, and everyone's kind of buzzing, really. The atmosphere is great with all the athletes, and one of the best things about the Commonwealth Games is the culture. I mean, there's people from countries that I've never really experienced their culture before. When they're all singing and when they're kind of dancing and stuff like that, when they're ready to walk into the stadium, it was all a new experience, which I really loved. And then when you get in there and they're like, this is Team England coming into this ground, it was a really nice experience, really, one I'll never forget.
Indeed. Well, before, okay, let me just take you back a little bit, Maria, away. What brought about your opportunity to be at the opening ceremony is the work that you did in training. Now, many people, who probably don't understand Paralympic sports, they would be, battling with a sense of trying to understand how you manage and the things that you have to overcome in training. Would you like just to give us an insight into your training environment? How did you prepare for you to be able to attain the qualifying times and the qualifying performances for you to make the England team?
It was difficult. It was 10 years of work, really. I had 6 months when I found out I was going to when I was moving. Those 6 months are very dedicated. So you know exactly what your goal is, what your target is, and what you want to achieve. But for the previous 9.5, 10 years, you're just training consistently to try and just make yourself better, try and knock the times down every year. I think for me, the first few years, you're just learning to love the sport you're doing. You're just learning the basics. And I've always been told until you have to get the basics right to be able to do anything else. And it sounds so simple, just running 100 meters running in a straight line, but there's so many technical things that come with it, and you're always learning from that. So I think as well, from being disabled, you have so many other things you have to think about. For example, 100 meters is one of the most important parts of the race. It's your start. Your start and how you're going to drive out those first 20, 30 meters of essentially making you win or lose the race. So, from a 35 perspective, with classification, that is the hardest part of the race, because part of the classification is our balance, our coordination. And you have to learn how to do a standing start. For an able body person, a standing start is very complicated, very simple. You don't have to worry about all your balance and stuff like that. You have to first get that right, and then you get to the point where you start thinking, okay, am I going to go into block? So that's your whole new system your body's got to learn, which to I'm assuming I've never really experienced this being a different person to an able body person. That's quite an easy adaptation. But for me, that took 3-4 years to get comfortable. And even then, when I was preparing for the Commonwealth Games, you're still not 100%. Every day you can have a good day or bad day. There's so many variations that comes with being a disabled athlete. And I think when it comes to training, every day is so different. And it's kind of up to you as the athlete also to make sure that they understand your body as best as they can. So then when they come to training, they're able to adapt the sessions and make sure that you're able to get the best out of the training system every single time you go on that track or every single time you go. The amount of work from so many people that go into it, I don't quite understand if we take a step back and reflect on it.
I can understand, you know, completely and thoroughly appreciate you, you know, sharing, you know, the challenges, you know, that come with disability sports, because the forces of nature that challenge the non-disabled athletes are the same, you know, on the disabled athlete. Non-disabled athletes struggle, even, you know, struggle themselves also with a component of performance such as coordination, you know, and that's in some cases, you know, with a balanced, you know, physiology. And when it comes to a disabled athlete that would have a variance within their physiology, you know, those challenges, I'm sure, are, you know, are even much greater. But you find a way, you adapt to it, and technically find how to harness those forces of nature to be able to cooperate with them for you to come about and produce the required components of motion. Great work there, you know, a huge salute to you for that. And that it takes 4 years, hey, it's almost the same duration that it takes non-disabled athletes, you know, to acquire some of these technical competencies in, you know, relative to the 100 meter race. Because your 100 meter race is a very, very technical thing there. Tell me about, I know your coach, Catherine Walker, you know, at the time, you know, leading up to your Commonwealth Games. How much exactly did you spend on your biomechanics? Because that surely should have been the biggest challenge in your preparation, was it not?
Yeah, when I was preparing for the Commonwealth Games, I had the juggle of living in London, having university. So as much as it was a physical challenge, going from training to six days a week, to also having the mental strain as well of university, I think that also made it difficult. But in terms of the biomechanics and stuff like that, we had a big system. I had a coach down near where I was living, and we had a very He was very much fitness. He was preparing me to train, essentially, for the hard, for the time of year, because we found out in the October, November, so we still very much training at that point. So I had to be ready. You have to do the half, which is the laps around the track and the bit that we have to hate. You got to do it. But with Kathy, it was very much like, okay, we're going to learn how to do everything technically to the best of my ability. That involved ensuring that all my starts were as good as I possibly make it. Making sure I was driving out of the block, making sure I was lifting up my knees when I was running, and then making sure that I run as hard as I can through that finish line. So it, with Kathy, it was very much the technical side, and that's what she's very good at as a coach, is making sure you are technically running to the best of your ability. And then I'd also go to the gym, make sure I was fit and ready to kind of do her sessions. They were very physically demanding. Like, for example, I remember one session we were doing, and it was, I had a band around me, and it was tied to the tent. And all my session was make sure I warmed up properly, and then I had to make sure that I was picking up my knees and doing like a high knee lift. As rough as I could for probably about 30 seconds. I've done it about 10 to 15 times in an hour session. And then the next day, my legs were burning. And it was absolutely killing. And I said to her the next day, we had another session, and I was like, my legs absolutely killed. We've done the most simplest session, but it was the right training point that I needed to hear that moment. And that was technically running as best as I could, even though it was hot, but the technical part, right?
Yeah.
So sometimes it weren't about how much you were doing, it was the quality of training. So it's not all about running and running. Sometimes that won't make you run quicker. Or the biomechanics that you share would be at opposite point. And the Commonwealth it's quite an early part of the season. We had to make sure that I done some indoor races just to get used to kind of racing again. On all of those kind of things. So a lot of it was just making sure that I was going to play rather than the physicality of it. When I got out earlier, I knew it was ready to do.
Oh, cheers, Maria. I can't help but muse, about that, I love biomechanics, I love neuromechanics, and I love the technical side of running. And I can't help but just muse at the thought of how much work that went in there. And I'd like to probe you a little bit regarding your mentality and your mental attitude to all this precision work, because that's what technical work is. A lot of precision. And you mentioned something interesting there, that because of the quality of work, you felt your legs were burning for doing little, but because it was a precise oriented type of work, there was a higher recruitment. You demanded a higher recruitment from your body, to be able to cut out those tasks. What would you say to the view that if I have a higher challenge, this is me thinking here, if I have a higher challenge because of some disability, I probably would pay more attention to technical matters to try and find more efficiency and effectiveness in how I can create motion? Would that be a true proposition?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, especially if someone with a cerebral palsy like myself, it's so fine margins in terms of making sure you get the most out of what your body can give you. I know I'm never going to run a 12-second 100-meter race. But it's just making sure that you're able to get everything out of your body as much as you possibly can. And when you're talking about kind of the mentality of it, for me, that's almost more important than the physical side. You have to make sure that you're mentally ready to race. And if you're not in that headspace and you're not going onto that track with a clear, empty mind, then you're going to have problems. There's no way around that. That took me 10 years to learn that. And I was lucky that when I got to the Commonwealth, it was very... My head was so calm. I've never been so calm before. It was the strangest feeling, but I think it's because I knew I was as prepared as I could be. As soon as you're not prepared, that's when you start worrying about and just not being ready to compete at the highest level you can.
May I pick you on something there about, you know, something very important in high performance? These were your first major games, and yet I hear you say you've never been more calm, you know, in a competition environment. How did you achieve that? How did you achieve this emotional regulation at such a major championship, which was your first?
To be honest, I don't know. it's the weirdest thing, because even now I still get questions about that. Like, how did I feel when I went up to the race? And I think the only way I can kind of get my head around it, I suppose, is for 2012, I'd done the tournament at the Olympic Stadium. We're essentially that when it came to the Olympics, the Paralympics, they had thought of every single thing that could go wrong, and they were ready to kind of fix any issues before the big event happened, essentially. So from that means we went to the warm-up track, we got the whole experience that Usain Bolt would have got, which I feel very lucky to have got. But before that race I'd done, I've never been so nervous before in my life. I couldn't eat anything. The thought of actually getting on that start line made me feel a little bit ill. It was just one of those, but then I think when it came to fast forward to the Commonwealth, it's pretty much, I can't be that nervous again. It was just, it was almost like a subconscious decision. I was like, you know what, I'm just going to enjoy it. Whatever happens will happen. I joke to some of my friends, I might fall over at the start line, I might not get up, or I'll probably trip halfway down the track. I almost envisioned everything that could happen and just thought of the positives that would happen. If I fall over, I then become a worldwide meme or something like that. It was almost so what if that happens? I kind of got the whole experience. And I think it goes back to the whole training of if I was as prepared as I could be, given the circumstances I was in. So my family were all out there. I had had the best 2.5 weeks before my race. I felt relaxed. It was a fairly warm night, so I knew I weren't tight. I had a good warm-up. And I just thought, what's the worst that can happen? I fall over. So what? It was kind of one of those. Subconsciously, that's why I was just nervous. And I ended up getting a PB out of it. I took something out of that.
Maria, I'll give you a little break there, so you have some water break. Let's have a meantime. I'm just gonna bring back the gold.
They weren't racing England. They were racing the world, and they beat the world.
Wow!
Come on.
This is a story of a country with two bowls greens and just an idea, and they have achieved a lifetime dream.
The athlete from Trinidad and Tobago, history is made! History is made! Michelle Lee Ayers!
Molly Arnold needs to break the newly secured world records. I can't believe that!
It's all flowing back. It's all flowing back, is it not, Maria?
Definitely.
Listen, wonderful. There's something else that interested me, you know, took my interest when we had our chat, you know, before this, which is your stance on disability sports. You know, you have a perspective that I think many people would like to, you know, to get a hold of and understand disability sport from that point of view, because I think many people have heard disability sport from non-disability, you know, platforms and authorities, as it were. I think it's important to hear how you define sport as a disabled athlete and a high performer, you know, in that view. Would you like to share some of those views, you know, with our viewers here? You know, why is, for you, disability sport not about awareness anymore? It is about performance, like non-disabled sport.
Yeah, I think it goes back to 2012. We had a great Olympics and Paralympics here, and we very much focused on getting our awareness. And just making it kind of a mainstream thing that you can have an able-bodied and a Paralympic kind of athlete, and kind of not think too secondly about it. But I think London 2012 done such a good job in raising that awareness in terms of that whole campaign. That thank you for the warm-up kind of whole slogan that they had going on, and I think they executed it perfectly for that time. And I think now it's getting to the point where most people know about Paralympic sports now, so it's just finding that balance between understanding that some people may not have, like young kids may not have been around in 2012 to understand that whole impact. You still need to continue to raise awareness. But it's also the point now of making sure that people are educated about different sports, so, and understanding the different classification system. And even now, I'm still always learning, and I don't think that will ever go away. There's so much to learn, and it's overwhelming at first to even think about the amount of knowledge that comes involved with Paralympic sports. But I think now the awareness is there. It's just all about making sure that we can educate as much as possible and trying to make it as popular as able-bodied sports. For me, there's no reason why, if we have able-bodied athletes doing athletics, we should have Paralympic athletes alongside. As a standard procedure, rather than having it as an afterthought. And I think that when it is an afterthought, that's kind of when it needs to be changed and made it so it's just almost compulsory. But I know there's a lot of issues that come with that, especially when it comes to disabilities. There's so many people involved in disability sport, so many classifications, so many events. If we had every single athlete in every single classification competing at every single event, the event wouldn't end. It's just a continual kind of process, essentially, because there's just so many different factors. So I think there is a balance. And that's one of the things that I love about the Commonwealth, is the fact that we were included. And I almost think it shouldn't feel like that. It shouldn't feel like we were just a small little segment. It should almost kind of be evenly split. But then I know there's a lot of issues that come with that, and it will take a lot of work to get to that point. But I think we are moving in the right direction. It's just making sure that we continue to educate everybody, even Paralympic athletes. They continue need to be educated about different disabilities as they go along. It's just making sure that the education is there available for people to access if they want to.
Yeah, well, I will come back to that, that theme there on a disability sport with the work that you are doing, with the charity regarding that. But I'm going to take you back to, the track just one more time regarding your preparation. You did mention there that you go to the gym. So you have a strength and conditioning program, as part of your development and your preparation. Would you like to share how that is? Is it something that is within your training plan? Is it something that you're just responding to, reacting to, or it is something that is structured out?
No, it's pretty much always been part of my training plan. When I was getting ready for the games, or even just before that, I'll go to the gym at least twice, if not three times a week. I think especially for someone of disability, the value of a gym session is essential, in my opinion, in my own experience. And I think with this whole lockdown, I've noticed a huge difference physically to how I was before the gyms were open to now. And it just shows how important it was to me in terms of, especially for someone with cerebral palsy, muscle stiffness and range of movement is key. And trying to minimize the amount of stiffness you have. And for me, the best way of doing that is being on a bike, being on a rowing machine. I'm not really allowed on a treadmill, just because the way you run on a treadmill is different to how you would normally run. And when you've got muscles like mine, it just will not respond in a positive way on a treadmill. So if I run, I only run on a track. So it's just about knowing your body and knowing what it can and can't do. And it's things like being on a machine at a gym. It has that range of movement set there for you, so it reduces your risk of injury. And you can use free weights, or you can use the machines they've got, and I always use the machines they've got, just because I know that I can increase or decrease the weight and know that that movement is already set there for me. Which strengthens my muscles in the long run. But doing that all freely outside of the gym, that's the last thing you want to do is increase your chances of an injury, so for me S&C was probably one of the most important parts of my training.
You raise some interesting points here that non-disabled athletes would take for granted. Your understanding there and explanation for why you are averse to using the treadmill, it's absolutely out of this world. I think many people would struggle to understand that, because the biomechanics of the treadmill and the track are different. And so what you are teaching the body on the treadmill is completely opposite to what you want the body to do on the track, Yeah, there's a place for the treadmill, but it's not for the purpose that you want to do on the track. So that is absolutely, absolutely brilliant, insight. And when you talk about cerebral palsy and how for you, muscle stiffness and range of motion is absolutely key, and that's something that you have to focus on. It brings to my mind, the whole need about stretching and the ranges of movement, ranges of motion, even in the non-disabled athletes who seem to take forever to understand the importance of all these things, because people take it for granted, absolutely, absolutely important that. Injuries. Yep. Sport and injuries are like hand and glove. What experience have you had, you know, with the sporting injuries and training and competition, and how have you managed that?
Injuries are horrible. They are every athlete's worst nightmare. I think I'm very lucky. I've only ever had one injury. As the years have gone on, I've had to learn the difference between what is an injury and what is this muscle tightness, or what is just you and your body being tired and learning when you need to rest and recover. When you've done a bit too much in a session, there is such thing of overtraining. So that was a fine balance, learning between the two. And I think the injury I did have, that was from not training in the right way at the time. I was doing a lot of 400-meter laps, just trying to get my fitness up. But over time, running in the same direction around the track continuously, that started to wear down my ligament in my ankle. Mm. And at the time, I didn't realise, oh, maybe I should run around the other way around the track to even it out. But I was young. You just go with what you've been taught. And at that time, I was taught, you run around one direction of the track because of healthy safety, so you don't bump into other people. So I was young then. I was only probably 12, 13 at the time. So it happened. I was growing at the time. That's also another factor, like growing pains and all of those kind of issues. But I think the hardest part of that injury was the mental side of things and how you deal with it. I think that's not spoken about enough in terms of sport. It is coming more popular now, kind of raise the issue. I think that's when you're doing a performance, that is 40% of your whole package. If you're not mentally in the right frame of mind, and that becomes really difficult when you've got an injury to kind of overcome that, because when you start to overthink or you start to worry about things, my immediate thing is to go out for a walk or go and do a training session or something like that. When you're injured, you can't do that. So I think that's one of the biggest factors that it's quite important and needs to be looked at more for athletes with an injury. But I'm very fortunate that I've only ever had one injury, and that was healed about 6 to 10 weeks that took to recover. So it's quite a short period.
Indeed. Right, Maria, I'm going to take you back to the Gold Coast, you know, just one more last time. And after that, I'd like you to tell us about the change of sporting codes within, you know, the disability sporting community. You know, why Paralympians change and why they are able to change, you know, sports between, you know, between Olympics or between the major games.
And a wonderful, wonderful gold medal for Kurt Burnley.
Helen, help me, the gold medal! It's England! Oh my goodness!
McMaster gets it right. He makes history for the British Virgin Islands.
Well, 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 well. So many sports there. And yes, it's a common situation, shall we call it that, you know, within the Paralympic community for athletes to excel in one sport and you find them in a different sporting court. Entirely, completely different sporting code come the next Olympics or the next major games. How do they do it and why do they do it?
Yeah, like you said, it's very common in Paralympic sports. The reason why normally is their classification is no longer in that sport. So for example, you've got Tokyo coming up. It may be, for example, an athlete with an arm amputee. It's a 100-meter runner, for example. Their event is then scrapped from Tokyo. Because it goes back to what I was saying earlier about there's so many different classifications, so many different events. It's hard to have an equal kind of display, if you like, of different athletes, different sports, and the range of disabilities that there are out there. So that's normally one of the reasons. And if you're an athlete who's 25, 26 years old, and you know what, I'm not going to have much left in terms of being physically fit to compete at that high level, you might start to think about, okay, this event in this sport, which I will then compete in, is at that games. All I then have to do is kind of adapt what I already know to that sport. So it's quite common, and It is horrible, and it's hard if you're an athlete and that event has been scrapped. It's a big blow, because you've been training for that for all your life. So a lot of the times, athletes will do everything they can within their power to get to that level. And sometimes that involves changing sports. So I wouldn't blame them, to be honest. It's making sure that if they want to get that gold medal, they do everything they can in their power to make sure that they can do that. So it is common. Another reason goes back to maybe an injury. Falling out of love with the sport that they've done. There's so many different reasons as to why that's happened. It could be funding. There's 101 reasons why. But the main normal reason is because of classification and the events have been set for those elite competitions.
You probably would not be the one to answer these, but you know, from your own understanding, why would a certain sporting event or classification be scrapped from a major championship? Why would that be the case? Is that lack of cohorts or competition or what?
I think the most high profile event will always be shown. For example, wheelchair sprints in athletics, there will always be that classification within a high level. But then when you look at other events like swimming, or just any sport really, it's really down to one, the level of participants, if they're to a high standard, there's enough competition in general. And also the entertainment factor. Entertainment is huge. When you watch an Olympics or Paralympics, you want to be entertained as your viewer. There is that part of it, but normally it is because of the level of participation, I believe. It's natural that there's some more disabilities. For example, cerebral palsy is a very common disability compared to another disability.
Okay. Yeah, that's on the general front. Let's go, with Maria herself now. Track and field, 100 meters. What's happening in the next cycle? Have you decided to change the sporting codes? If you have, what skills are you taking? Technical skills are you, transferring to your new sport?
With my classification is very broad classification. So for me, I have decided to kind of take a step back a little bit from athletics. A few reasons why. One, I just felt like I had lost that competition element from athletics because I weren't in that close bracket of competing for the medals at a high level within my qualification. To put this into perspective, in the Commonwealth Games, I ran 19.3 400 metres. The winner of the race, I believe she ran about 13 seconds. I may be wrong on that. Over 100 metres, eventually 5 seconds. It's pretty much near impossible, I would say, for my level of ability. And like I said, that's after 10 years of training and learning about the sport. So it, for me, it didn't become as competitive as it did when I first started. And I love a competition, and I love to continue learning, and I will never say that I've learned very well. But I just felt like, okay, now I'm at an age where I want to learn something new. I went to a Paralympic trials, and I got picked up by table tennis. So I've started that process of giving it a go. I wouldn't say I'm at a high level yet, but there's a lot of things that I can do from what I've experienced with athletics and move out of tennis. Stuff like S&T, learning how to dedicate your time for school, the time management, general biology, and I understand my body a lot more now. I know what I can and what I do. The only thing I really need to learn that's different is the tactics of the sport and how to do the sport itself. So, a little bit about how to hold your all of that I've got to learn, but in terms of the actual game side of things and the physicality side, I've already kind of got that in my basket, essentially. So, it's just making sure that I'm able to adapt to that. I don't know if anything will come off it. I've got to that stage where I was like, I don't try now, I'll never know. So why not give it a try? I'm still going to the track, I'm still with caffeine, still doing a bit of work. It's just the training we're doing. It's not so much focused on 100 metres, it's more focused on making sure that I've got good coordination and flexibility, and we still needed in 100 metres. I'm sure if Kathy said right next week we're going to do 100 metres, I'll be more than happy to do so. But it's just making sure that I've adapted my training slightly to accommodate table tennis. But I'm always going to have one foot in the athletics bubble, because it's something that I've always loved and I always will. So whether that means coming back as an athlete, I'm still fairly young, so I can always come back, but I just thought now's the time to give it a try and see what happens in a year's time. If it's not quite working out, I can always come back to athletics and know that I've had a good break and get going again.
Yeah. Do you have any major championships that you have set your sights on?
At the moment, no. I mean, in table tennis, I still need to get classified. I still need to go through all of that process. I started table tennis about a year ago now, but because of lockdown and everything that's happened, I haven't been able to go through that whole process that I would have hoped to have done by now. But in a way, that's benefited me in other ways. So the lockdown taught me to kind of focus more on the mentality side and making sure I educate myself more, reading books properly and listening to my body more, eating properly again, which when you're working full time, a lot of that goes out the window. So it's good to kind of reset. And I know when I spoke to a lot of athletes, they've been doing the same. And sometimes that's just as beneficial as it is to spend 5 days a week in the gym lifting weights. Sometimes you've got to sit back and kind of reflect a little bit. So, yeah, I mean, there's been pros and cons, but it's life. It happens.
Yeah. Maria, you've been super duper, you know, very informative, and I'm sure many people have found your story inspiring there as well as entertaining. But before we go, I'd like you to share with us, you know, the work that you are currently doing. You've done lots of work for charity, you know, based on your passion for, you know, the disability sport. What are you doing? What sort of work are you doing? And how can other people get involved in it?
Sure. So I've recent years that there's this charity called Heart Disability Support Foundation that I've been doing a bit of work with. Not so much now. I'm working full time in another field. But I always kind of go back as my home, if you like to call it. But they've been doing great work over the last 2 years. The whole thing around it is making sure that as many able to be as possible, also raising the awareness about Paralympic sports and disability in general. So a lot of what I used to do, and the charity still do, is going to schools, mostly primary schools, and educating the children on sports, on Paralympic sports, and kind of teaching them a little bit about what it is, letting them have a go. And just kind of having that experience and that understanding of what it is, but also making it normal for them. And then when they do watch it on the telly, it's almost like, oh, I know what that is, and they can educate their parents. So for example, we do sports like football, wheelchair basketball, boxer, so many kind of Paralympic sports. We also do animal body sports, which is handball, just to kind of mix it up a little bit and to kind of make it feel like it's not a different sport. They're all sports together, just some of them have been adapted just to everybody's needs as much as possible. That's kind of like what a charity does, and it also goes around to daycare services. So people who are disabled, they're also able to be involved in sport as much as they can. So that's great work that the charity have done. And during this lockdown, they've been doing discos and fitness over Zooms and stuff like that. So they've done really well.
Thank you so much, Maria. And if you were to give out one word of advice or encouragement to a potential Paralympian out there, you know, who are listening to you and, you know, they're thinking, wow, how do I go about doing, you know, achieving all this? What would you say?
For me, the most important thing is enjoyment. Making sure you enjoy what you do. Because the minute you're not enjoying it, that's maybe you should take a break. For me, I've always enjoyed athletics. Don't get me wrong, there's always going to be difficult times. There's times where you've just been doing 200 meters, and the last thing you want to be doing is smiling to your coach, and they go, you're going again. There's a difference between working hard, and general enjoyment of where you're like, you know what, I hate going to the track. As painful as it can be, second, as long as you're enjoying it, then I'll just say, just keep doing it, and then whatever will happen will happen. As long as you're putting the hard work in and enjoy the sport, then that's the most important thing.
Well, Maria, well put. Listen, we possibly could talk on forever, but we have to give it a stop. Give you a break, give me a break, and give listeners a break. Listen, for me, Maria, it's bye-bye.
Well, thank you for having me.
Cheers.